The new game should totally be called Upbeat.
You know what? You're right. Of all the basic 2D gameplay loops, platforming may be one of the more complex. No more moving along grid lines, now there's all this physics and collision to worry about as well. Character keeps moving unless next to a wall sounds straightforward enough, but what if the character is 2 pixels away from the wall and their movement speed is 4 pixels per frame? These are the little things your code has to worry about. In that case, I'd use a for loop or repeat function to move the character 1 pixel at a time until it detects a collision, then stop, but I digress. Upbeat is also a rhythm game, which adds one enormous 3-letter word issue on top of all that, lag. How do we stop lag from making the audible beat and the beat as kept by the in-game timer from desynchronizing? See, I examined the music files and discovered the length of each beat to be about 630 milliseconds. At 60 frames per second, that comes to 37.8 in-game frames. Now, if you're new to coding, here's a quick insider tip for you. You can't have 0.8 of a frame. So if we fudge it and say each beat is 38 frames, the music is going to eventually desync from the in-game beat if it plays for too long. On top of that, the system might experience a lag spike at any time that delays the in-game metronome for a couple of frames. To handle all of this, I've opted to cut all the instrument tracks down to around 10 seconds or 16 beats apiece, and instead of having them automatically loop when they're finished, I have the code play them once every 16 beats as tracked by the in-game timer. They'll still desync, but not to a degree that you'd notice before the timer ticks over and everything resynchronizes again. As for lag spikes, I've incorporated a built-in GameMaker variable called Delta Time, which stores information on how much time has passed from the system clock rather than the number of frames, apparently. I don't know, I just copied this bit of code from a website I found and it seems to work. So the nuts and bolts of the platforming to a beat idea is working, but one thing I'm worried about is what to do for the tertiary loop. Jump to the beat, fine. Get the entire song playing, fine, but then what? If I had more than one song, I could just declare the level beaten and have the player go to the next one on the playlist, but I don't, and I'd have to redo all the timing for a different song anyway. So I need to think of another way to ramp the gameplay up. Some kind of score attack mode is probably in order, and for some reason the words boss fight keep flashing across my mind. So that was the little update for what will end up being a fairly little game. Now, what broader game design concepts can we talk about this week? Well, I still need to do the main character sprite, so let's talk about walking animations. I used to make point-and-click adventure games in the old Maniac Mansion puppet theatre style, and the ones that I've actually released are in quite a small minority against all the ones I worked on and never finished. So if there's one thing I've made a lot of in my time, it's walk cycles. And now I'm going to show you my method for making them, right after you've all finished laughing at my incredibly old version of Photoshop. Look, I've tried to upgrade, but they keep moving all the functions around and I can't be bothered to retrain. So start with a box that will contain your character's sprite. It needs to be the same size for each frame in the walk cycle. So the first frame is going to be the sprite when it's at its widest, with the front foot forward and the back foot back as far as they'll go. We start with the front foot, draw it in the bottom right there. Then copy-paste that to the next sprite box, but moved backwards the same number of pixels that the character will move every frame in-game. In this case, our character moves 2 pixels per frame, so we move the foot back 2 pixels. This will ensure that the foot on the ground moves with the ground, and it won't look like he's moonwalking. So keep going down the frames, paste in the foot, moving it backwards 2 pixels each time, until the frame where it has become the back foot. Now we've got the foot, it needs a leg. So first I draw a line where I want the waistband to be, that the leg will connect to. Note that the waistband goes up and down, as the character's height will change slightly over the course of the step, shortest when the feet are fully outstretched, and tallest when the leg on the ground is fully vertical. So here's the first leg filled in. I'll copy all these frames over and darken them slightly so they can be the other leg. Now we continue drawing the first leg on top of that, as it does the other part of the walk animation, the swinging of the leg forward. Again, I start with the foot and make sure it moves a roughly equal distance each frame, although since we're off the ground, we don't need to worry about syncing with the movement speed on this one. I'm having him kick his legs high because he's a dancer, but for a more sober walk, the foot need only be an inch or two off the floor. Just remember that the foot tilts forward as it leaves the ground and back just before it lands. Without the tilt, it'll look very stiff indeed. Next, we fill in the leg. A bit of eyeballing and guesswork is required to determine where to put the knee, but you can always redo it if it doesn't look right. Just make sure the leg is roughly the same length above and below the knee, and you're golden. So once we've copied that leg, darkened it and moved it behind the first leg, that's both legs done. We're not finished, but I'm going to put all these frames into Game Maker now and see how it looks in motion. Looking surprisingly good, it turns out. I think putting some exaggeration in the movement really helps it pop. Whatever that means. The next thing I'll usually add at this point is the head. Again, it moves up and down with the straightening of the leg on the ground, but I'm also having it move back and forward to emphasize the way he shifts his center of gravity to bring his knee up high. So after the head, I'll draw in the spine, and that will provide some guidance for the arms. Obviously, for a basic walk, they'll just be swinging nonchalantly back and forth, remembering, of course, that the arm swinging forward has to be the arm opposite the leg going forward. Otherwise, you look like a nutcracker toy. In the past, I used to skip this bit by just having the character keep their hands in their pockets, but I didn't always have the excellent work ethic that I have today. For this character, they're going to be flamboyantly bringing their fists up to their face with each swing. So I start by essentially doing the same thing I did with the feet. I draw the hands in their extreme positions first, and then copy-paste that for the halfway point where the hands have swapped places. But in this case, I'm going to fill in the middle frame next, the point where the hands are crossing over, so that I can more easily determine how much to move the hand in all the in-betweeny frames. And there we have it, a few fill-ins and adjustments later, a lovely smooth walk cycle that anyone can do. But if you truly have absolutely no faith in your animation skills, you could always make retro, grid-based, super-deformed JRPGs like Final Fantasy VI, where the walk animation is the bare minimum 3 frames, left foot forward, right foot forward, and a neutral standing pose to put in between. Hell, if your character's symmetrical, just flip the first sprite and then you only need 2. I happen to think this sort of animation works well in this context. It emphasizes the exaggerated retro look and the stiff adherence to the grid lines. Just don't run it at 60 frames per second, Jesus.
Hey Yuxi, what do you use to get the sounds for these games?
Oh boy, let's advertise something other than Game Maker Studio for once. For sound effects, I go to freesound.org, an extremely useful, searchable database of homemade sound effects that anyone can upload to and download from. Make sure to check the licensing of any sound files you use to see if the creator would like you to credit them for it, but otherwise, go nuts. I don't know what I'd do without it. Go back to nicking footstep sounds from Half-Life. Now as for music, Upbeat has been an unusual project for me in that the music kindly provided by Ian Dorsch came first. Essential as music is if you want your game to have any kind of emotional weight, it's usually the very last thing I worry about. For Pre-Flight Panic and BRTV, I just used tracks from Kevin MacLeod's website, Incompetech. Kevin MacLeod is a deeply public-spirited person who has created a huge library of ambient music tracks, covering all kinds of moods, anyone can use in their creative projects for free, in return for a small credit. So I generally haven't been using original music. I know some solo developers can make music on top of everything else, Pixel of Cave Story fame for one, but creating music is a talent that completely eludes me. Part of the reason all my older games are freeware is that so much of the audio was nicked. I think all the times I've had original music in my games, it's been because a musician got frustrated and insisted on making me a soundtrack before I embarrassed myself further. If you can make music, I have a lot of respect for you, because I wouldn't know where to start creating a song. I suppose I could bang some saucepans together. Be good for atmosphere building, if it was the atmosphere of a room with too many saucepans in it.